Sometimes you need to wait for multiple promises to complete before either using all of their resolved values or moving on to something else. For example, waiting for multiple API calls to finish before gathering all the results and using them to form another API call. We can use Promise.all to wait for multiple promises to resolve before doing something with the result. In this tutorial, we're going to use Promise.all to create a new promise that resolves once all the promises passed to it have completed. We'll learn about when and how you can use Promise.all. We'll also implement a fault-tolerant version of Promise.all, which will still resolve even if one of the promises passed to it rejects. Promise.all is a super useful method on the promise constructor. The reason it's so useful is it allows us to orchestrate multiple promises together in order to wait until all of them have completed. It does this by creating a new promise from multiple different promises. Promise.all takes an iterable, typically an array, full of promises as its argument. It creates a new promise which resolves once all of those promises have resolved. It's important to note, though, that promise.all is what we consider fail fast. That means that the new promise will reject as soon as any one of the promises passed to it rejects. Here's an example of using promise.all to wait for three different timeouts to complete. We're passing promise.all an array with three different promises. Each one of those promises will resolve after a timeout. And promise.all is returning us a new promise, which we're assigning to a variable called all. Each one of these promises is also going to resolve with a number. Let's go ahead and run this real quick and see what the result is. The result that we got is an array with 1, 2, and 3. What's happening here is that promise.all gathers the resolved values of all the promises you pass to it, and passes that as the resolved value of the promise that promise.all returns. So on line 7, where we're attaching a then handler to the all promise, the results argument is going to be an array that contains whatever the resolved values were of the promises passed to promise.all. The position of the value in the results array correlates to the position of the promise in the array passed to promise.all. So because the promise in the first position in the array passed to promise.all resolves with a 1, 1 is also the first value in the results array. Another important thing to note is that all these promises are running concurrently. So if you add up how much time these timeouts should actually take, it adds up to 6 seconds. But let's run this again and you can see for yourself how long it actually takes. You'll notice that it actually takes 3 seconds to execute instead of the 6. That's because all these timeouts are started at the same time. So the 1 second timeout resolves, the 2 second timeout resolves, and then the 3 second timeout resolves. But promise.all doesn't resolve until all promises resolve, so it's going to wait until the very last promise resolves, which in this case is a maximum of 3 seconds. If these promises were running sequentially, or one after another, then it would indeed take 6 seconds for this promise to resolve. But since they're all running concurrently, that is, starting at the same time, it only takes as long as the maximum running promise takes, which in this case is 3 seconds. Here's a bit of a more real-world use case for promise.all. In this example, I'm using Node Fetch, which is an NPM package I've installed in order to use the Fetch API in Node.js. So here we have a list of to-do IDs. We want to get all of these to-dos from this API that we have here. We only get one to-do at a time from the API, so we're going to need to make an API call for each of these IDs. Since none of these API calls depend on one another specifically, this is a great example for using promise.all because we can run all these requests at the same time. First, we'll create an array of promises by mapping over the IDs array and creating a fetch request for each to-do. Then we can pass that array of promises to promise.all and attach a then handler to the returned promise. In that then handler, I'm mapping over the array of to-dos and creating a new array of just the titles from the to-dos. And in the next handler, I'm going to console.log all of the titles. We've also attached a catch handler to handle any errors. Now, if we run this, we should see all of our titles being logged to the console. So the benefit of promise.all here is that we're able to write really clean code that allows us to wait for all of these promises to finish before we move on. We were also able to start all of these requests at the same time, which allows us to complete all the requests much faster than doing them one after another. Something to keep in mind here, though, is that promise.all is fail fast. So if any one of these fetch promises rejected, you actually wouldn't get any data from any of the other requests. When a promise in promise.all rejects without being caught, the entire promise will reject and return to you the error of the very first promise that rejected. To demonstrate this, I'm going to push a rejected promise into our array of promises before we pass it to promise.all. Now running this file again, you'll see our error log to the console. That's because once promise.all sees this rejected promise, it's going to skip immediately down to this catch handler and not run any of our then handlers over here. That's because the promise returned by promise.all itself rejected, and we're logging out that error that was passed through from this rejected promise. If you really need the results of the other promises, even if one or more of them has rejected, there's something that we can do in order to make promise.all fault tolerant. What we can do is map over all the promises being passed to promise.all and attach catch handlers to them to make sure that their errors will be caught. And in this case, I'm going to return the error, so it's actually going to be part of the results that promise.all is going to pass to the then handler once all the other promises have resolved. If you do this, make sure that you're filtering or checking the results of promise.all, because making it fault tolerant like this means that the results from promise.all will now contain things besides the result of successfully resolved promises. If we run this file again, we can now see that we have undefined in our array of titles we were logging before. That's because the error object isn't what line 12 was expecting when it's mapping over the todos looking for their titles. So like I said, make sure that if you're going to be using a fault-tolerant promise.all like this, you take into account the fact that you might be getting the result of unfulfilled promises. So the last thing we'll do here is we're going to write another then handler, which will filter the results array to grab all of the errors so that we can properly log them. And then from that then handler, we're going to return an array which contains all the results minus any errors. Running this one last time, we'll see that we logged the error, but also continue on to the next then handlers to finish the rest of the program. So to recap, we learned how promise.all can be used to create a new promise, which will resolve once all the other promises passed to promise.all have completed. We learned about some of the use cases for promise.all, like running code after a batch of promises has completed, and also starting promises concurrently. We also talked about how to make promise.all fault tolerant and recommended some things to think about if you do so.